right from the customer discovery to the customer engagement to the customer negotiation, the site tours, everything is being done digitally in partnership with the developer. So the customer doesn't necessarily even need to leave his home today.
It's such a big privilege and a pleasure to reconnect with everyone, our distinguished audience, our attendees, and some of who have also joined us previously offline for our leadership events. To share with you, we've received over 300 registrations, a very good number, keeping in mind that 90% of whom are CEOs and CXOs. One of our key industries that we are strongly engaged with is the real estate industry. In response to the COVID challenge, the Blue Circle also has accentuated its digital presence. One of the many modes we will employ is our weekly webinar series, our digital publications, and we're also building a handpicked domain-focused expert pool drawn from among our leadership community or from our member base and its associates that will help guide businesses during this era and post the COVID era also. And today, we've invited thought leaders from different subdomains to give us perspectives from the developer, the technologist, the market and investment advisors on how is the real estate industry managing the COVID impact and preparing for the future. So I deeply thank you all for tuning in today and for joining us. So now, in the best interest of time, I will just mention the most relevant designations of the thought leaders on the panel. We have with us Mr. G. Raghavan, CEO of Bharti Urban Developers, Mr. Prabhu Ramachandran, founder and CEO of Facilio, Mr. Shajai Jacob, CEO GCC Middle East Anurag Property Consultants, Mr. Prashant Bindal, Chief Sales Officer of Lodha Group, Mr. Gagan Randev, National Director, Capital Markets, Colliers International, Mr. Yash Gupta, Managing Partner, YGR, and the moderator for the session is Mr. Pavan Chaudhary, author, CEO, and public intellectual. Kindly note that we will have two rounds of Q&As with the audience and two rounds of polls to gather meaningful insights for our publication and research. So thank you very much, everyone. And now I request Mr. Chaudhary to please begin the session, sir.
Hello, everybody. It's a pleasure to be with you and with this enlightened panel. The audience is also full of thought leaders, and so is the panel. The real estate sector, even before it entered COVID, it was facing tremendous headwinds. There was lessening confidence in the retail buyer, in the institutional buyer. There were issues of GST and RERA coming in through legislation, which were adding to complexities. The investor was also hesitant. And all this problem was present before COVID. So it entered the COVID era with a comorbidity. Having said that and underlined the seriousness of those problems, which need to be circumvented, history also shows that upheavals like COVID do not only bring problems, they bring opportunities also. In fact, the history of real estate, construction, and infrastructure industry has always been shaped by disease. Till a few centuries back, when it was felt that plague or disease is being caused by toxic vapors, noxious vapors coming from the soil, the miasma, the dodgy miasma theory, the pavements, millions of square kilometers of pavements were lined and cemented with flagstones, which brought a big jump to the sector. Cholera brought the birth of sewage systems and zoning laws, which took real estate preferences locationally to different places. And the clean aesthetics of modernism, white clean aesthetics of modernism, was to some extent inspired after the tuberculosis era, where light-filled sanatoriums brought in and inspired the white-painted big halls flooded with light, the easy-to-clean tiles in the bathrooms, and the ubiquitous recliner chair from mid-century. The bubonic plague brought the rat into focus, and the focus on the rat not only brought in so many patents, but it changed drain pipe design, it changed threshold design, and it changed even the foundations. So, though it is true that some inventory, some houses, some buildings came into disfavor or lost value, there was another new set of buildings, new set of homes, offices, which gained value, new locations emerged. So all these headwinds of COVID will also bring some tailwinds. This is what we feel, and this will set the tone of the discussion on an even keel, which will allow our panelists as well as our audience to come in with their points as to what are the headwinds, how they should be handled, and what are the tailwinds which should be prepared for and ridden on. So on this note, I pass the debate on discussion on to our panelists, and let us start with G. Raghavan. G. Raghavan, what would be, in your opinion, the main headwinds and tailwinds, and how to handle the headwinds? Raghavan.
Thank you. Before I even get started, I just want us all to be present to one reality, that it is us who invented this whole new phraseology called VUCA, even much before COVID-19 became a very major source of uncertainty. One thing that COVID-19 has absolutely made sure is that there is no ambiguity about its impact. There's no ambiguity to its impact across industries. Therefore, much as we will talk today about the real estate industry and the impact of COVID, and the tailwinds and the headwinds around it, we cannot but recognize the fact that they are highly integrated into every other sector. So having said that, I think I look at our real estate industry in terms of four main segments, namely the residential, the retail, the office, and the hospitality segments. There are other segments such as the industrial manufacturing sectors, institutional schools and hospitals. We'll keep that aside for the moment. But I think that way COVID-19 has impacted and will continue to impact for each of the sub-segments will play out a little differently. We will do the biggest of mistakes if we simply take a generic impact called COVID-19 and tend to apply it across all industries. So each industry, each player will be different. And actually within the industry, the factors are not going to be the same for every player. So it's very critical. Those who are going to come out of this successfully are those players who look at the industry for what it can offer, but look at their own specific firms in order to recognize what are their unique strengths and what are their unique constraints that they need to now redefine their operations from. So as we go along in the evening, I'm sure that we'll have opportunities to talk about specifically what are the tailwinds that are happening in the residential as well as the headwinds, whether it is the emotional elements of wanting to own a home today compared to what it was before COVID, or people looking at it as alternative investments and people are realizing that, hey, residential place in my portfolio is not a bad thing to have today. So there are factors like that. Definitely job losses and loss of income is a big, big headwind in this business. Office is the most talked about space today, primarily because of work from home. they say that if you practice something for 21 days continuously, you're very likely to end up with that as a good habit. So working from home has happened twice the length of the 21 days. And lots of people out there are thinking, hey, gee, this is not a bad thing to do. So why don't we do this? And the employers who have never believed in this, I've been talking to so many senior people in the office leasing space. They all are surprised to the extent to which it's working. But I would say the jury is still out as to how much of adoption is going to happen, what are the challenges in it, and if there are going to be new things happening there in terms of what are the tailwinds and headwinds. Just to spend a minute on this, I think in terms of the tailwind, we should not forget that nobody forced this office-based market to grow. The growth happened because of the growth in the business environment, cost optimization, and the benefits that it offers for companies to locate in India and operate for the world. Now, have those fundamentals gone away? I don't think those fundamentals have gone away. That's a very strong tailwind that will continue to be there. Sure enough, it is getting seasoned by the fact that work from home is going to add a dimension of the quantum of requirement being a little different from what they would have had coming into the game. So that is going to be a changer. But also remember, social distancing is not going to allow the same utilization of space as was possible before COVID-19. So there you have a real concoction of factors that is going to end up into a steady state, which will be a new steady state. And there is also currently, Pavan, I'll just take this 1 minute and pass it back. Currently, the biggest topic that is going on is on the supply side, namely completion of projects and the concerns about the migrant labor availability, not availability. I'm sure as the evening progresses, we'll have more opportunity to talk about. But when it comes to migrant labor, in my mind, there are two parts to it. One is the human aspect. These people have been holed up in their own camps for the past 40 days, worrying about their families and everything else. So it is but natural for them that the moment they think there's an opportunity to go back, they want to go back. Because that is their vantage point. It is the employers' community who need to kind of rise above that and point out to them the bigger picture in terms of what is possible and why it's a good thing to be continuing to be economically engaged. And you will go home at the normal time that you normally go, namely Diwali, Dasara time people used to go, and that can still happen. But I think that is on the migrant labor side. The last point I want to say is, I think this migrant labor is clearly a set of solutions that have been waiting for a problem. What I mean by that is, it is no rocket science that everybody needs to be more productive. It is no rocket science that people have to be skilled. It is no rocket science that people have to be trained in safety methods. It's no rocket science that there are productive methods, building stuff outside and bringing in here and doing. So lots of productivity measures were always there. But the industry needed to be woken up in terms of, hey, do you want to continue to depend on this extent of migrant labor, or do you want to do something that is within your hands? So these are some of the points I have as opening comments. And as we go along, I'd be very happy to participate and answer the questions.
Excellent points. And I was just reminded by your discourse that the power equation between employer and employees has often been changed by such upheavals. The Black Death brought the demographic correction, number of peasants on the field reduced, their importance increased, and they were given much more privileges. And similarly, perhaps work from home also will improve the relative power of the employee against the employer, because it may bring the gig economy, which is also coming. So the employer will have to keep the employee attracted to him also, because the employee may be employed by more than one employers. And interesting, very good information you have shared. I would like to go to Gagan and ask Gagan for the headwinds which the investors are thinking that they are facing, this sector is facing, as far as investments are concerned. Gagan.
Yeah, so I think, carrying on from what you said and what Raghavan said, I think the period of upheaval that we've seen over the last couple of months is something that at least I have not seen over my lifetime. The real estate industry, I think in India, was going through a fair amount of tumult in the last 5-6 years. There were sectors like retail, there were sectors like office, warehousing, which were doing phenomenally, attracting a lot of interest. And there were also sectors like residential, which had been suffering for a long time. And despite, RERA, GST being ultimately items which are ultimately there for the strength of the industry, they also promoted their own sets of challenges for the industry. So as things stand today, what is the industry grappling with? The industry is grappling with short-term challenges, which are, of course, going to be overcome in the short term. And if I were to very quickly tell you the challenges in the short term, you have, say, if I'm a developer and I have a large amount of space given to tenants, whether it be on the office space or on the retail side, a big chunk of my time today is going into negotiations. Somebody says, I'm not going to be able to pay you at all. Somebody says, I'm not going to be able to pay you partly. Somebody says, I want a moratorium for a couple of months. So those conversations are happening. If I was a developer, besides those conversations, I'm also worrying about, when is my labor going to return? Am I going to find people to kickstart my projects in the next couple of months? How much of delay am I going to face in my projects because of that? If I'm a buyer, a retail investor, etc., at this point of time, I'm looking at, is it a good time right now? Should I be more worried about my job, my liquidity, my cash flows? And something as buying as mundane as a house can come sometime down the road. And if I was an investor, I think it's a good time to sit back, look what is happening in the industry, what are going to be opportunities which are going to come across. So let me quickly, from the short term, jump to the medium term and what I see happening in the market in the medium term. I think office is going through its set of upheavals at this point of time, but I think by and large, I expect the office sector to remain at similar levels. There are going to be certain markets like the South markets, which are very strong, and I expect there to be no impact at all. There could be a little bit of impact which could be visible in the markets of, say, Mumbai or NCR. Why do I say that? While we have a huge amount of focus currently at work from home, I think the jury's out, as Raghavan was saying, on whether it is going to be something permanent. There are ultimately going to be concerns of data privacy. You can build in all the safeguards, but can you stop somebody from taking a camera and taking photographs of the screen? So those privacy items will remain. You may have a situation where somebody says that, I was looking at taking on 50,000 square feet of space. I now look at taking only 35,000 square feet because I'm going to budget for less employees. But on the other hand, if I was taking 40 square feet or 50 square feet per employee, I may need to ramp that up to 75. Why? Because I now need to adhere to social distancing norms. So net-net, I expect that to balance out. I don't expect that to, the office sector to be hit too much. The sector which may get impacted in the short term or the medium term is actually the co-working space, because companies may decide that the experiments they had taken on in the last couple of years on the co-working side, where, it was a very easy way and maintaining flexibility and taking on space as and when you need it. But now you may decide, I may need the safe confines of my own office because I have control over safety, hygiene, security aspects. So that is something which could happen. What is definitely going to be impacted, I think, in 2020, at least slightly negatively, is the retail sector. Mall rentals are not going to be what they were. There are already renegotiations going on. Revenues, people, whether they were on part MGs, revenue shares, etc., that is going to impact hotels. Hotels are going to be a big casualty, with the 2020 being a very, very small part of revenues of what you saw in 2019 and beyond. So these are two sectors which are going to be challenging. Raghavan was talking, and Pavan was talking about opportunities. I think one opportunity which is already clearly playing out is the opportunity on the warehousing and logistics space. I think in the last 2 months, the importance of e-commerce, is even more prominent, if it was not already prominent in the last couple of years. That is only going to take on, go from strength to strength. You already have a trend where people are coming to us and saying that identify a small, earlier you used to be looking at 25 acres or so to set up large facilities. Now people are talking of city-centric facilities for last mile delivery. And that is how it is changing on the opportunities there. The other opportunity I see in the medium to long term is as we become more conscientious in terms of hygiene, safety, you may see branded and the bigger players on the co-working and the student housing side take even more prominence, because people would prefer to pay a little more and be there because simply you will trust the hygiene factors. So I think as a starting point, I think I've touched on a lot of different sectors, a lot of different industries, but I'd like to reserve my thoughts now, and I'm happy to expand on these in the question answers or subsequent interactions.
It was a very comprehensive intervention on the headwinds and some tailwinds. Coming to Prashant, what do you think, Prashant, are the headwinds which the retail investor in residential estate is facing, or retail investment in residential state is facing?
If you look at it, for last 4 or 5 years, residential can be divided into two parts. Although the general view has been that the real estate industry has been going through a tough phase for last 4 or 5 years, but let us divide it into two phases. And also let's accept the fact that what is real estate for? The real estate is there for providing shelter. For providing shelter, investment, and also esteem. So these are the three reasons why people buy. Now, in the residential, the sector which is there for the shelter piece, that is the mass market as we call it, or in a Bombay, which is say a less than a crore, it could be, this amount could be for luxury sector or premium sector for the other cities, but for Bombay, less than a crore is a mass market segment. That segment has been growing phenomenally well. Let us accept this fact that because the basic need of real estate is shelter, and not everybody buys it for just investments. There are two kinds of buy that happen. So in the residential sector for last 3-4 years, there has been a huge amount of buy in. For our case, for example, nearly 100,000 clients visited our sites in mass markets. And out of that, 9,337 bought it. So the number of people, and I'm sure if you look at the overall, if now the RERA data shows it very clearly, Bombay is about 50,000 crore market. So 37,000 crore market out of that 50,000 crore market is less than a crore market. And none of them, most of it is bought mainly for shelter. Now that shelter, that need for shelter will always remain, and is actually going to improve. Is actually going to improve, and that is what we have seen in last 2 months. The need for a ready-made home has increased phenomenally as we are interacting with the clients digitally, of course. From a headwind perspective, the luxury and the premium sector, that is one sector where people buy when they upgrade. As their income grows, they upgrade, they buy it for investment, they buy it for esteem, they buy a brand. That is where the investments have been low in last many years, especially if I talk about Bombay. Now that market is where it is still going to be tough. Although because of the kind of challenges that stock market has seen, like some of the clients have given us the feedback, because generally if we're doing the client profiling, there was hardly any space for additional money for real estate because all of it was going to equity. But now the kind of crisis which equity market has seen in last 2 months, people also realize that real estate is not that segment where the pricing yo-yo happens on a day and a night basis. If it may happen, it may not drop to that extent. You do not lose 30% of your investment in 10 days or 6 days. If it happens, it happens gradually. So that way, there is a sense of change happening across the segment. The premium and luxury segment will take some time for it to evolve, but I am sure it is happening for the good. Because in real estate, the segment that was there in terms of investment was anyway low. It can only go up. Whereas the need for the shelter, that has improved very significantly. That has improved very significantly, and everybody, in fact, in 30 to 50 lakh housing, the demand is very, very good. In fact, it has increased very significantly. Of the, you know, we have done close to 500 bookings since the lockdown has happened, out of which more than 400 bookings are in this segment. And we could never believe that this could happen. And when talking to the clients, there is a very significant demand, because demand is for ready to move in, which is ready to take care of their interests under challenging times.
No, very good. Very good point.
If you look at it, there are both the opportunities and residential ready to move in, right price segment, the need for the shelter increasing very, very significantly. Everybody wants a house now. Everybody wants a house now. A house which can give him
yeah.
and can take
because,
care of the challenge.
Yeah. Because upheavals like this, COVID has brought in the over dependence on your shelter to a landlord can be very anxiety giving. And that is why maybe more and more people may want a shelter of their own. It is possible that there are certain complexions in the shelter which will get accentuated in the demand which comes. Maybe shelter should be also more safe in different ways. And regarding the investment point also, I fully agree with you. Though there is a saying that fools build houses and wise men live in them, such sayings really get challenged after something like COVID. Also, I remember another saying, some of my businessmen friends used to say why they don't invest in a home. They said that dukano se ghar bante hain, gharo se dukane nahi banti. But I'm noticing that their views are also changing in this regard. So going to Yash on this. Yash, if you would like to add something both to what Gagan said and what Prashant enunciated in terms of headwinds before investors, as well as the real estate retail investment outlook.
Thank you, Pavan, and thank you to the host for having me here. Pavan, I really liked your analogy of kind of seeing how the world has changed, and both in a good way and a bad way with the past epidemics. And I think that was an interesting insight. Dots I have not connected in the past, but I would love to do more of. That said, I think I'm often bemused when I'm on webinars like this, and I've been hearing a few as well, where we're all trying to talk about something with a little bit of certainty, where we do know that the only thing that's certain is the future is completely uncertain going forward. There are so many different variables that we are dealing with, and things can come out in so many different ways that I would say my first point is, I say with complete modesty and humility that I am completely uncertain about what the future will be like, but I try to surmise a few thoughts around it. My second point here is really what we want to discuss is what we think is a new normal. I think there are two really key questions which will define the new normal. And again, saying we don't really know what the new normal will be, but we can think a little bit about it. I think the first question that will define the new normal is there a vaccine or not? If there is a very effective vaccination, and we think that can affect, really protect people, not just for in the current term, but also in the longer term, I think the change will be very different. And people will alter their behavior. A lot of the old behavior will come back. And the key determinant of the new normal in that situation will be the economic considerations and not the pandemic or the health considerations. Because I think what is certain is the economies globally will go through a very uncertain and possibly even a recessionary phase going forward. And that will define the new normal versus the pandemic. So for example, if virus is not a threat, let's say 24 months from now, maybe the de-densification everyone's talking about may not be such a real reality, because if there is a slowdown in the economy, people will need densification of offices. So that's my first question. I think the new normal will be defined by how effectively are we able to come up with a vaccine, and how permanent is that vaccination's effectiveness. Second, I think we are all very, very focused on talking about how much will the demand come down by? How will the demand characteristics change? How will buying behavior change? How will the way we live or work or play or shop change? I think what is, and therefore the impact on rents, impacts on power equations, etc. I think what we really should be very, very considerate about also is we may be looking at a much greater shrinkage of supply than we're thinking of shrinkage of demand. If the real estate industry is already going through a really, really difficult patch, if the economic conditions are really extreme for the next 24 to 36 months, there may be a rationalization in the industry of the number of participants and thereby the supply. If supply goes down much more acutely than demand does, we have a very different new normal that we're talking about. And that's the other unknown that I worry about, or I think spent some time thinking about. So what is certain in a situation like this? In my opinion, there are two things that are certain. One, behaviors that have been altered in today's environment, driven by fear, may go back to the old normal once the fear is off. People used to say, we will never get on a plane again after September 11. People just saw those people who saw World Trade Towers fall down, never wanted to be on a plane again. And 18 months later, the aviation industry had the best damn time it used to have and the highest occupancy and the highest usage there is. So we have seen in the past that behaviors that get altered by fear go back to the old normal once the fear goes away. The second, however, behaviors that find a new normal because they're a lot more convenient. Suppose we talk about work from home. Suppose we talk about e-commerce. And people saying, hey, this is interesting. I can be a lot more effective with a lot less friction. I think those behaviors will change and continue to remain changed. So that's the first certainty. I think the second certainty is the real estate norms will change, whether because of economic considerations or because of pandemic, they will change. And developers that are a little bit more proactive, or real estate participants that are a little bit more proactive on flexibility, on design, on operations, will be the ones that will succeed. So for example, the conversation I was having this morning was with a large owner of retail malls, and the discussion was maybe the new normal is rents which have no minimum guarantee. They're all variable. Suddenly the power equation will change. Suddenly the way the contracts will change. Suddenly the tenant selection might change for mall owners. So that is certain as well, that the norms and the playbook for real estate will change. How it will change will really depend on, are we dealing with economic considerations or virus considerations? I will stop here.
I think wonderful. You brought a very good perspective here, and also prompted us all to be even more modest or humble. And so what I would like to say, then, we are not talking about a new normal. We are talking about a new flux. The normal is still to arrive. We are still in a flux. And well, the point regarding change also, which you mentioned, is very important, because this has been seen by plagues also. The Black Death or some plagues which lasted for 7 years, they changed us unalterably. But many of the plagues which were only short-lived, they brought a sudden shock to us, but we very soon reverted to our earlier behavior. And as far as supply is concerned, on this we should discuss a little more, because I feel that worldwide there is more money held in real estate even now than stocks. And a supply of that is investment will also depend, I feel, on how safe the other investments which compete for the money are. Coming to Shajai on that point, Shajai, what would you like to add to what has been said so far about the headwinds as well as the cautions which Yash brought up? And thereafter, I will go to Prabhu to talk about the tailwinds and how his sector can trigger some tailwinds.
Pawan, thanks for having me on this webinar. And I think a lot has been said so far. The fact is, when you're the fourth speaker of six speakers on this, there's not much that you can add when most of it has already been said. And I think all of us know what it is all about.
In which case there is a separate question for you. See, you are a star.
Which I will want to come to separately. But let me just add just as one piece that this catharsis that we are in right now, this pandemic that we are in right now, this issue that concerns all of us are in right now has not been created because of real estate. The last big crisis that we remember was emanating out of real estate or some alliance out of real estate. So I think what we are going to face is definitely a culmination of forces which will be from a global aspect, come from various industries, and that will actually affect us. So we'll have to actually stop thinking internally and start thinking externally too. Start thinking about what are those forces which are affecting the other industries. For example, a small example, the office segment in India, 40% is the absorption is by American guys. I mean, it's American companies which are leasing them. And with America going into a sort of a depressionary stage, that will affect ours and our markets tumultuously. So that is something that we will have to factor in, right? The other aspect of the NRI population who were actually strong investors within India, with the global markets in a tizzy, financial markets in a tizzy, that's going to really, bring a lot of sentiment drop. And thereafter, that's going to hit the overall investment grade appetite that's going to be held by NRIs within this industry. The third being, where was residentials moving? It was moving on the affordable side of the business. With the amount of job losses and redundancies that we continue to see, the labor movements that we continue to see, I get a feeling that there is going to be an effect on the affordable housing industry itself. So there are going to be lots of macroeconomic forces which will affect our industry, and I think we should all take cognizance of that fact.
Yeah, I think you have very well stated your point, and I will now come to Prabhu, who I will ask that how has technology helped in COVID now, and how it will help us through this new flux. And thereafter, in the interest of fairness, we will go to Shajai back to talk about the tailwinds so that he is not at the end of the tail every time. Yeah, go ahead, okay. Prabhu.
Yeah, so quickly about the outlook, I will go with a very cautious note because there is a lot more uncertainty on how things will pan out. So they say that, in cities like New York, the rent collection was 90% in March, but it is expected to be 60% in April. That's the kind of drop they're seeing. But from a tailwind point of view, a few things is one, on the behavioral changes, there will be some positive changes where the relationship between tenant and real estate owner will be more trust-based. So it will be more of a partnership-driven, trust-based because of the importance of the whole office, either it is an office or real estate, the emphasis on security and all those aspects. Plus, even the forecasts that the tenants are going to do now are going to be a lot more realistic, a lot more stable when they come and take rent, all those stuffs. And on the other side, this thing will help if you look at the operation side of real estate post-construction, because in last decade since there has been like a very fast urbanization, real estate companies have been more focusing on growth, but the operations and maintenance have been generally overlooked. And there is a lot of wastages and leakages in that area. And this might trigger efficiency in the whole real estate cycle where both the tenants and the owners are going to focus on how can I make things efficient in terms of workforce, in terms of utilization of energy, water, everything. So that is an enforced good thing where the whole operations and maintenance will adopt more technology, become more nimble, more agile, so that it comes and becomes relevant in this case. That will also have an impact on the whole climate change thing because real estate is the number one consumer of all forms of electricity. And that will have a positive impact on that becoming more efficient
is going to have a positive impact on climate change. So those are the two areas where one is behavioral, more of a partnership-driven trust base. And another one is companies going and embracing more tech for efficiency.
Yeah, also there is a lot of talk as to you already mentioned that how efficiency will become so important, and I think you've made a very good point. Thank you. So I come back to Shajai with two questions. First is what, in addition to what Prabhu has said, are the tailwinds in various sectors he anticipates which will be able to encounter at least or counter in the midterm the headwinds he has spoken about? And the second is a direct question to him, which is about his perspective on commercial projects in India and GCC in the times to come. I will start weaving in the questions so that the audience also gets answers to what it is looking for from you. Shajai.
So Pawan, I think the first question I will attend to later. I'll take the second one first, which is on the attractiveness of commercial real estate. And I think the question was on the attractiveness of commercial office real estate from GCC investors.
Yeah.
I think the fundamentals of that remain very simple. The need for a second income, the need for an investment grade, high yield asset, which can actually fuel incomes when NRIs come back to the country. And that will continue to play, that will continue to stick. We are seeing a lot of offtake, especially in good quality assets. We are seeing NRI investors focusing not merely on residential, but also on the commercial grade real estate in the prime markets of the country. Bombay, Pune, Delhi NCR, of course, Noida, Gurgaon play a very big role, Bangalore to a certain extent. And this will continue to get fueled given the fact that NRIs in their current markets are facing certainly a tepid time from a sentiment perspective. There are job losses, there are redundancies, there are wage reductions, there are job cuts which are happening. And primarily, one needs to safeguard and overcome this risk. And that's the reason why they're actually migrating to such asset classes. The other thing is NRIs were also looking at a lot of equity. And like some of the other speakers had said, you know, the shift from gradual equity to real estate might not happen just on residential, but will also happen on the commercial standpoint. However, one caveat over here is that NRIs need to be extremely cautious. The trust deficit needs to be overcome. There are certainly a lot of players in the market who are not really offering the right quality product, or there are products which are there which might not even see the light of day. So NRIs need to be guarded against that, and of course try to put their monies into proper A-grade commercial assets, which are there, and developers will definitely want to move into such, given the fact that there is going to be a glut in residential, given the fact that there is going to be a demand slowdown. So commercial assets which are saleable, A-grade, might come up. So that's one from an NRI investment perspective. From a tailwinds perspective on what's going to drive the sector, I think it's, you know, we don't really see demand coming back immediately. There will be certainly fence sitters who were actually sitting on assets or decisions to buy residential or to lease commercial. Those will anyways, fructify. But if you ask me, where is that fresh demand going to come from and why is it going to come from, more importantly, I think it is because of, firstly, that there has been a repo rate cut, a reverse repo rate cut. I think the government has done whatever fair bit it could. You know, I don't think we should leave it all to the government to do, because I think India is a large organization, a large country. The government might not be able to fulfill everything that has been done outside of India by the other governments. And therefore, I think what will happen is that there is going to be certainly a leverage that will come on the lower interest rates, which will lead to lower home loan rates. There is going to be a lot of site digitization. There is going to be a lot of technology play, which is going to actually add to a lot of benefit to the customer. So, and I think that is going to really create that kind of tailwind to maybe improve demand. Look, we're not seeing a V-shaped recovery at any point of time. At best, it might just be a gradual U-shaped recovery. And if that has to happen, you know, there are certain factors which will play, which I've actually mentioned to you.
Okay, great. So We'll have to take a pause here because there are a lot of questions coming and also on my WhatsApp. So let me, and we have discussed the headwinds as well as the tailwinds in my preamble as well as in the interventions of some speakers. So I would like to come to some very good questions which have come up. So the first question is addressed to Raghavan. What steps are advised in inventory management, liquidity, and cash flows for the developers? Again, I repeat, what steps are advised in inventory management, liquidity, and cash for the cash flow for the developers?
It's a good question. If you don't mind, can I just add a couple of points to the office tailwind that he was talking about, because I think it's very important to set that context, add to that context. Is it okay?
Sure. Please do that. Do that. And I will come also to Yash after you, if he would like to add anything on the question which has been posed.
Yes, I will. Yeah. I will certainly answer this question. But what I wanted to, because we were in that zone, I
thought. Please.
One is, I clearly see three distinct tailwinds for office space market in India. One is, there's a lot of challenge about H-1B visa holders in the US. This being an election year, there's a lot of pressure on minimizing the number, exiting the numbers, and so on and so forth. And these are hundreds and thousands of H-1B people who are basically talent on two legs. When they come into India, when they come back to India, they're not going to be sitting alone. The work is going to travel with them. And all the organizations which were basically deploying at-site workforce, this workforce will come into India, and the work, there is not enough talent in the United States in the first place for all the work to be replaced with local workers. So work is going to travel into India is one of the bets I will take. The second thing I will say is, in this situation, I think like Yash was saying, a lot of American companies are undergoing a phenomenal amount of cost pressure. And the cost pressure, the first place to look at is reducing cost. And there are opportunities that India can provide for them to really operate out of India from a cost pressure point of view. Third, I think the very important point is, there's been a lot of talk about Chexit or China exit of a lot of manufacturing companies. Now, it's just not manufacturing. Manufacturing is the core that drives a lot of growth in the economy. Now, we exactly don't know how well equipped we are as a country to leverage a large part of what can exit from China. In other words, broadly speaking, global realignment of supply chains and sources is going to drive a certain amount of tailwind for India. I think these things are important from an overall industry point of view, and those will all augur well for office space in India, is what I think. Now, do you want me to answer the other question, or do you want
Yes. And after you, I'm coming to Yash, and I will try to announce in advance the panelists who I'm coming to, so that he can also collect his thoughts. That was the purpose. Go ahead.
I think as far as inventory is concerned, I will keep it very simple. I think there are lots and lots of tools, both from a planning side as well as supply chain related technologies and tools that are available. By a very, very good process of planning and really going to lean methods of construction, there's a phenomenal opportunity for us to be more productive with inventory levels in the supply chain, in the overall value chain. The second thing, as far as cash is concerned, it's a very tricky question, because those who have the cash want to hang on to it. Those who deserve to be paid are waiting in the corridors. I think there is a balance to be achieved in terms of a sense of partnership and a sense of long-term supply chain enablement to be able to deal with the cash in an optimum manner. Now, having said this, one area where everybody has to look at and everybody is looking at is, where can we eliminate waste? Where can we eliminate fancy projects? Where can we eliminate fancy positions that we originally once upon a time thought it's nice to have? It's important for us to revisit those things. So these two are some things I would say that from an inventory as well as a cash point of view to tide over the current situation.
Great. So I come to Yash. if you'd like to add something to what steps are advised in inventory management, liquidity and cash flows, what Raghavan has mentioned, and also what role can the government play and what are the kind of interventions expected. After this, I will come to Prashant for him to answer if he thinks that COVID-19 will change home buying preferences in the affordable sector. And after that, I'll come to Gagan with a new question which has come regarding, which says, with the need for localized storage becoming more important, would you agree with me if I say that storage, warehousing, cold storage segment would do well going forward, and that a number of micro markets would open out for the segment in tier 2 and tier 3 towns? So that's the sequence for now. I request Yash to come in, please.
Thanks, Pavan. And I just taking off, I have three thoughts. The first one, building on inventory. I think the biggest change that will happen in inventory management is really the fact that developers will no longer be influenced by just the consideration of what can they sell quickly, because which used to really be the driving force, or people were managing cash more than they were managing projects sometimes. I think the mindset would be, as we've always done at my previous place at Hines, you did not announce a project till you were clear that A, you had financial closure, and B, you could actually complete the project even if you were not able to make one single sale. People will be a lot more sensitive towards building and selling, especially in an environment where interest rates come down, it'll become a lot more feasible. The strong players will get much better debt at much better pricing. And the ones who can afford to build and sell will both get better pricing as well as better patronage from the buyers. And I think that could be the new norm for residential on inventory management. The second part with the government, I think we can have a whole session as to what we want from the government, and every real estate participant has his own laundry list. The only one thing I think that could really help the sector, given how intensive we are on capital requirements, is can we just reduce the cost of capital? Whether that means lower mortgage rates, whether that means lower construction loan rates, whether that means more liquidity, there are various forms it can take. But if the cost of capital comes down in the industry, it will have a multiplier effect across the entire value chain and supply chain. And that would be my one request. And the last point in office is, I could not agree with Mr. Raghavan more. The only one thing I'll add to his tailwinds is, I do think there will be a flight to quality and a flight to safety even within the office space. People will have the opportunity to move to better quality developers and better quality buildings for the hygiene factors, for the operation factors, for the design factors that we talked about in the past.
So coming now to Gagan. Gagan, the question, Prashant. The question for you, Prashant, was that, do you think COVID-19 will change home buying preferences in the affordable sector?
I think I will start from where Yash left. I think the most important thing that is happening is the flight to safety and flight to quality. I think that is a significant change that we can already see, and that will certainly happen. The large brands, the big developers who can give very quality product will be the demand of the day. Otherwise, in affordable section, what was there was the major need was, you know, the major questions were very distinct from luxury and premium was, what is the size? What are the amenities? What is the price? But now it has shifted. We can already see the shift happening, because who is able to give them the best product apart from pricing? So that flight to quality is a very significant shift that is happening in affordable segment. The second shift is, There were two kinds of houses. One is under construction and one is ready to move in. Now, the need for under construction was the ability of the client or the consumer to pay in the phases, pay in 2 years' time, 3 years' time. But now the distinct movement towards the ready to move in flats is very, very visible. It was visible even before COVID. Now it is becoming even more significant, and it will become more significant. The reason being is, first of all, because of the GST on ready to move in is zero. That makes a huge difference, especially since it's an affordable segment. The home loan rates seriously are now the lowest ever in the last decade. I think that is one very significant player for affordable segment, because almost 95% of the buyers in the home loan segment in the mass market or affordable segment are the home loan buyers. So that is one significant player. The other thing that is very, very important is that the role of influencer. You know, when a home buys, what happens? I'm sure all of you bought home. That has been my experience. You know, I've seen so many buyers buying. Nobody can buy a house without an influencer. The buyer is generally a male. You know, the male. The influencer is 90% cases is the female, the wife. The wife, in some cases, the mother. And in some cases, like, but that's mainly, there's a third is the financer. It could be luxury premium where the SME segments, the Babji, Pitaji come as a sense of financer who is interested only in the price piece. But in this new phase, you know, the influencer has become very, very important. This is a consumer behavior I'm just observing on a day-to-day basis while interacting with client digitally. The role of women have improved very, very increased very significantly. Earlier, you know, in affordable segment especially, the buyer, very aggressive male would come, will fight for the price, I want this, I want this. The demure female would sit aside and would listen and would give her one or two comments. But now, because of this, the role of the safety, the role of how, where is the kids' room, where will they study, where is the difference, how will they do, where is the playroom, where is the safety aspects, has become very, very important. And it is a revelation for us. And that is how for us also to improve how to take care of the interest of the influencer. And without influencer, no buyer can buy a house. I'm sure we all know that. So in this respect, if I can, total it, the key summit, the key is movement towards ready to move in houses with good amenities, good developments which give all the kind of amenities. How do we factor in the women in this whole scheme of things, because they stay at home for the longest time? How can we convince them? They are becoming very prominent, and this home loan is becoming very, very critical. The home loans are very aggressive. So I think, but it all depends on, to a very great extent, you know, I think Shaji pointed out to that. It all depends on the extent to the economic losses that have happening stem now. Because if they continue for quite some time, as an economy, we keep on falling down and there are huge amount of job losses, then that could be a very big deterrent. Because if people do not have jobs, then it could change the very way the buying sector can get them. If the losses are still stemmed down where they are, I think there could be a very significant shift in the affordable sector.
So I'm getting messages on my WhatsApp. Some women are there among the participants. They are saying that we were in command before COVID. Now we are the only ones in command because we have accommodated our husbands in our homes. So they fully agree with you that their power has further increased. Coming to Prabhu, before I come to you, Gagan, because he was at the tail end and we have not been able to bring him up. On this point, Prabhu, what Prashant said, I feel that there are more changes which are coming even in the lower income residential estate requirement. For example, one of the points which I heard in many of the webinars or Zoom sessions, which we did in our company, was that the lower level sales executive was saying that I live in a one room house, and there is a bed and there is a table, and I wish there was a curtain or there was something to have a kind of modular kind of flicking the switch kind of a thing. Also, they are saying that they also are looking at in lower income or middle income category, contactless pathways. They are also, can all these sensor technologies and all which have come and other technologies, can they give him a better choice? And what do you think this choice might be in the times to come, Prabhu?
Yeah, see, all of this boils down to, I would say, it's all trust. The trust between the owner of the building, either it is commercial or residential, and the occupants. That is the trust factor is going to have a lot more value now, because if you own a commercial building, And the first thing is, how do you make sure that people are back to office? As an employer, as a building owner, they have to come and sit in the office. Of course, there are going to be a lot of behavioral changes, but the need is to people to comfortably, confidently come and use the space. So that is where, of course, technology can help, but everything is going to be revolving around how can a building owner build a trust to the tenant, so that things like various aspects like what kind of measures they are taking, are these transparent, are these measured, are these done consistently, and this is where tech will come and play, either it is sensor or a software. How can you measure these, and how can this be exposed to every stakeholders? We will soon start seeing like displays in different portions of the real estate, either it is office reception or in case of a community, like different places, there will be displays showing that how many visitors are coming into the systems, into the premises, how much of sanitizers are being used, whether is it increasing, decreasing, and how often the lifts or the elevator buttons are being cleaned. This is going to be very, very important, where how can we establish a trust with the occupants that the building is safe to be used. So that is where tech can come and help both the owners and the occupants. So tech can, one is visibility measurement. The other part of tech is, how can you bring in the behavioral change, the positive behavioral changes? If you look at last 10 years, some of the major behavioral changes we have seen is, how do you order food? How do you order like a cab? So that such kind of transformational changes will come in real estate, where whether it is social distancing or cleanliness or sanitization or even contracts that are very dynamic, changing every month, these kinds of changes will be triggered by technology. But everything is going to be built around the trust factor, I would say.
Great. Coming to Gagan, other than the storage and warehousing comment, we would also like, and these facilities going to tier two and three, tier three towns. There's another question, kindly address that also. How do you see the residential real estate markets being impacted in tier two and three towns, like state capitals, after COVID?
Okay, sure. So let's start from the first question, which is on warehousing and the movement to city-centric warehousing and tier two, tier three locations on warehousing. I think if you look at the history of warehousing, and we all know the kind of money which has been poured in to the country on warehousing and logistics in the last 3-4 years, it started off with massive facilities outside city centers, you know, typically 20 to 50 acres, 75 acres, where people built state of the art, I don't want to start naming people, but people like Indospace, etc., built state of the art facilities all across this place to house goods. I think what is happening, and we are seeing it even more acutely now post COVID, is you're seeing people advertising Amazon Pantry, 2-hour deliveries, Flipkart, the Supermart, again, 2-to-4-hour deliveries, etc. And that is going to become more and more and more the service USPs of e-commerce players. So whether it be an Amazon, a Flipkart, or a Big Basket, etc., quicker delivery is going to be the norm. Now, the only way that is going to happen is by having city-centric, what we call warehousing facilities or white good delivery centers. So the movement from those large 20-25 acre facilities to smaller half an acre, 1 acre kind of facilities, it could include building it up, you know, from a greenfield perspective, or you acquire a building and reconvert it. I think those we are already starting to see, and that is only going to happen. As we speak, I think in the last year, and as we speak currently, there is a huge boom going on in tier two locations, with people aggressively looking at markets like Lucknow, Chandigarh, Jaipur, the Coimbatore, and building up warehousing facilities around these places. And that trend is only going to continue because e-commerce is here to stay. And in these days of social distancing, you are going to see a little bit of fall in footfalls of people going out, venturing out every second day to buy essentials, and that is now going to be catered through e-commerce. So that trend is definitely there. The second question I'll come to is on the list.
Before you come to the second question, let me just alert Shajai that I'm going to come to him with a question that how to build client confidence. Sorry, go ahead please, Gagan.
Yeah, so the second question you had was on impact of residential in tier 2, tier 3 towns. Now the fact of the matter is I expect post-COVID there to be a period of at least 3 to 6 months where there is going to be a little bit of fall-off on residential. I think Shajai also talked about it. And the fact of the matter is that there is definitely going to be a demand pushback simply because I think people are going to be more concerned about what happens to me at work, whether I am working as an employee, whether I've got my own small or medium enterprise. I need to be more worried about the cash flows, about the security of my job. So I think that decision is going to be pushed back. That trend is going to be no different whether you're in a tier one or a tier two, a three town also. But I also expect that there are certain things that we have got very habituated with over the course of the last month plus, and which is that we have been able to reasonably work from home. Now, that is something which is spoiled us. That is something which you're also going to see as a trend where currently you had a situation where it won't be unoff that there are lakhs of people traveling from a Delhi to Gurgaon, lakhs of people traveling from a Gurgaon to Delhi. People travel an hour and a half up and down without thinking too much of it. I think you are going to start seeing towards the end of the year a change where people would want to prefer to be closer, to stay closer to where they work. Now, that could involve some shifting. In smaller towns, you don't necessarily have that commuting hour and a half because you don't have the kind of traffic. You have smaller towns, etc. So you're not probably going to see that much of a phenomenon as you will see in metros. But definitely, I see post 6 months there to be a little bit of bounce back coming on the residential side, which is going to be on the basis of much lower rates of home loan. If you look at where we are today, compare it to a year back, you're already down about 100, 125 basis points. And I believe that we are going to be about 200 basis points lower in the next 6 months. So that is in terms of lower home loan rates. You are probably going to see capital values erode by another 10% or so. Given that, I think residential is again going to be a decent buy. But I think we'll have to wait about 6 months for that to become a decent buy.
Great, great points. So coming to Shajai, and before that, let me alert Yash and Raghavan for the last two questions. The question which I'm going to ask you is regarding migrant labor. That with the migrant labor moving out, where do you think is the construction help going to come from? And would the builder community start nurturing and maintaining local labor? And wouldn't this result in increased cost of production if it does so? So your opinion on the displaced migrant labor and how the government will handle it. Yash, I'll begin with you. And then end with Raghavan on a supplementary answer on that. Plus, whether he feels that building is too important an area to be left just to builders. And is there a necessity of bringing sociologists and all who have only sporadically studied this area in a more enduring manner to impinge on projection as to what the society is now looking for? So those are your questions. Coming to the question to Shajai Jacob, how can we build or rebuild client confidence?
So I think that is an extremely important point at this stage, Pawan. The client confidence had already been eroded to quite some extent. And now there is, with the sentiment drop, it's not as if client confidence is going to come back. It's only going to get further deepened. So there were two parts to it. One is that it needs to address the execution risk. And the second part, it needs to address the trust deficiency. And there are several layers to it, you know, how it can come back. And the first layer is, for example, how does a strong brand, you know, address client confidence? And we all see how it is playing out. You know, stronger brands today, more confident brands, brands which have actually stood the test of time. And today, I would say more corporate brands. Yash was part of Heinz. So Heinz is an extremely corporate brand, and it managed to circumvent all of the construction risk, you know, whether even if it's the Lodha Group from where Prashant is currently. I mean, these are all strong corporate brands, whether you talk Godrej, whether you talk the Tata Group, whether you talk any other brands, whether it's Brigade and some of the other larger developers. So building a strong brand is extremely important. But along with that strong brand comes a host of confidence building measures, and the client when he's comparing, you know, investment in A product versus B product will in today's time try to navigate himself into, even if it's at a price premium, into a more stronger brand. So that addresses one part of it. The second part of it is basically the execution risk. So if he somehow his financial commitment is mitigated or taken care of whilst addressing the execution risk, it would be far more easier for him to have confidence in that developer. And that's the reason why suddenly we're seeing good quality brands coming out with these payment schemes. And some of these payment schemes are extremely lucrative, you know, whether it's the 1090 scheme or the 595 schemes or the 199 schemes. While the subventions have gone away, and they went away early last year, which were bank subventions, and now developers were actually coming out with such products to address this trust deficit and thereby build client confidence. The third part is the entire process of sale. You know, we are seeing an entire post-COVID or during COVID situation wherein clients are not able to visit the site. So today, if it's anyone who purchases a property, I mean, 7 times out of 10, they would like to go in and visit the site, have a look at the property, you know, and see for themselves, ascertain for themselves whether the property meets, you know, at least what's written on the brochure. But having said that, in today's time, it's not possible. So therefore, how do good brands, good quality developers digitize the entire process? And how do consultants come out with an entire technology prowess to do it? So, you know, at Anarock, we've actually come up with the IDSS, which is the Integrated Digital Sales Solution, which is right from the customer discovery to the customer engagement to the customer negotiation, the site tours. Everything is being done digitally in partnership with the developer. So the customer doesn't necessarily even need to leave his home today to actually have a look at how the site is progressing. And that is something which is very important, you know, from a sales perspective and from a customer confidence building measure perspective. So the customer from his desktop can actually see what's the approach road, what's the site look like, what is the surrounding area, what are the hotspots of social interest around the area. You know, he is far more amenable to invest in that product vis-a-vis any other product. So this transformation is something that we're seeing automatically happen, and it will keep on increasing. The last point that I would like to make is capital protection. I mean, the customer today, there's a segment of clients, especially amongst the more premium clientele, who are having the popular or the perception that prices will soften. So they might or might not is anybody's guess at this point of time. But even if they do, if the developer is willing to put a capital protection guarantee at the end of it, saying that within the next 8 to 10 months, even if the price does soften a bit, the consumer will be able to get the benefit of that price softening, you know, or the fact is that if he is put in a booking for a particular property, you know, at the end of the day, if his requirements are not met within a period of 90 days or his expectations are not within a period of 90 days, his blocking amount is refunded. You know, these are the schemes or the tools or the manners in which the confidence towards a particular product can be met. And we're seeing that. I mean, Prashant mentioned that he has done quite a lot of bit of sales. You know, at Anarock also, we've done managed to do it. Godrej has managed to do it. So lots of developers are doing a lot of some of these things. And these are actually, you know, helping in building the confidence. So that's the various layers on how one can actually, you know, rebuild confidence among the client set.
Very good points. In fact, your point regarding technology, can generate the new glue of trust is very valid, and we can add to the technologies which you mentioned, also blockchain, etc., which will make sure that whatever is being said or claimed is actually correct, and the blockchain endorses and validates those claims. So great points. Yash, one more question. It's not leaving us. Though the panel had decided that we will GST, going into GST would be too specific, but this point is coming again and again as to how that GST input credit, which has been made unavailable to the real estate sector, is there a way to circumvent that? Then to the migrant issue, and then I go to Raghavan.
Yeah, I'll leave the GST issue for other panelists, because I am not as involved with the residential at the moment. Okay. But on the issue of migrant labor and with the issues of should developers be the ones who should be in charge of all the real estate? My point on the first one is, the point you mentioned was, will people have a difficult time to get labor? Will people have to keep labor on their own site? What else will they do? Will they have to use more technology? The answer really is yes, yes, and yes. I mean, I think there is no one silver bullet to this issue. People will have to try everything they can, which includes both reduction in the amount of labor they use, which could be automation, which could be technology, which could mean leaner manufacturing processes, etc., which could mean steel structures. It could be a bunch of different things that one could do. So on one side, developers will try what they have to innovate to reduce the amount of labor they need. Second, they will try innovative methods to keep the labor that they need and how to reduce the volatility around that. Will it all translate into an increase in cost? We'll have to see. I think in the short term, yes. Long term, maybe. Maybe technology can offset, can provide some gains which offset the increase in labor costs. So that's the point on migrant labor. With regard to the second question as to should development be left with just developers alone, I would say even today that's the case. Today, I mean, a developer is not the urban planner. Cities have very high, there's a lot of regulation about what needs to be developed, where it should be developed, how it should be developed, how high it should be developed, what the demographic should be, how much for weaker section of society, how much for sale, et cetera, et cetera. I think, and that will only increase, because I do think there will be social demographic effects and impact and shifts because of economic considerations that will happen post-COVID. And that will only exacerbate the kind of regulations that the government will put, especially for residential real estate going forward, to provide a level playing field for all the different constituents within an urban environment.
Great. Great points. I'll come to Raghavan now. Raghavan, please share your views on how this migrant displacement challenge can be handled. And one part of building should not be left to builders has been very well answered by Yash. Let me ask you another part. Architecture, it is also said, should not be left to architects alone, because there are socio-behavioral demands which keep coming up. And these demands should reflect in their plans so that emerging needs can be caught and met. So on these two points, what is it that you would like to say? And there are many other questions which are still to be answered. I will try to propose a way of how the people can stay engaged with the panel. Raghavan.
Thank you, Pavan. Basically, on the migrant labor, I just want to give a certain sense of dimension. As far as I know, the numbers are around 50 to 53 million workers are engaged in the construction industry. Second, migrant labor going back home is not a new phenomenon. It happens every year. During the festival time, they go. Whether 100% of them go, or 80% of them go, or 50% of them go, it doesn't matter. That they go home is a normal thing. Having said that, what is abnormal is the timing of the wanting to go back home and the circumstances under which they want to go back home. So this has introduced a sense of doubt whether are these people going to come back at all or not. First of all, I want to say that when construction was permitted, many projects, construction work started. Even in our own company, the construction work has been going on. The workers have been looked after in our own camps, and they've been around. When we were allowed to start the construction, the work started. A very small percentage of them have actually left, and another small percentage of them have expressed desire to go back. Therefore, the number of migrant workers going back home, the absolute number, is not non-material or not insignificant. But in a sense of proportion, that is not the main story. It is a main story because that is a story worth publicizing. But in my opinion, there is a sense of proportion that needs to be brought into this situation. Second thing I would say is that, is it possible to engage local labor? Will the developers resort to employing local labor? Let me tell you, if it was possible, they would have done it already. The reason why they have not done it is because when you need labor of a certain skill in certain proportions, you have to depend on migrant labor. I don't think that issue is going to be resolved by simply looking around for labor locally. It's just not available. That's not a practical solution. Having said this, there is also a fear. Is there an increased fear about COVID? Is there an increased fear about saying psychologically, hey, why am I going all the way to Bangalore from Patna? Why don't I find something to do and make my own simple livelihood and stay back here? So because of that, will a certain percentage of people not come? Moot point, likely to happen. But will the industry be impacted? The industry will be impacted if they don't do things proactively in terms of improving the productivity, which I had mentioned earlier, and Yash alluded to this in his statements. So industry has no choice but to look at productivity, where less and less intensifying of labor usage has to be done. So this is the all-round way. Just as we say 53 million people are engaged in the construction industry, it's a big dependence by the construction industry on the labor. But don't forget, there is a flip side to the coin. 53 million people livelihoods also depend on this industry. So I cannot expect all of them to throw away their livelihood and not come back. So I think it is a little bit of an exaggerated concern, definitely a sociological issue, a human issue. We are at the height of the issue at this point of time. That's all true. But let's not miss the big picture without seeing the bigger statistics, is my point about the migrant labor. As far as building is concerned, I think when it definitely comes to homes or office spaces, if we do not think enough about the people elements of it, inside the building as well as outside the building, and their whole process of how they come in, what they do, what they want, what they're looking for, if you're not present to the occupiers' requirements, the residents' requirement, we will not do enough. Therefore, I do completely agree, particularly residential is more a social science than a pure building or construction industry. The industry will do well by looking at the spaces inside. It's not the size of the apartment that is going to matter anymore. What you do inside of it, how do you make life happen the way that life is going to change inside the homes? Equally important is revisiting the way that we have designed community spaces in residential complexes. We were able to do many things, and with the intervention of social distancing, one needs to revisit that and also be creative about it, be customer focused about it. And there's a lot of sociological science that needs to be brought into, purely starting from the customer and working backwards.
Great. So thank you very much. I'm already a student of socioeconomics, and I have also realized this more and more because 84% of a man's average person's life is spent in buildings. Last 1.5 months, 100% of our lives have been spent in one portion of one building, which is our apartment. So we've become very, very sensitive to this, and we do feel that the socioeconomic grain will once again change the market, and those who spot it first through the sociological lens which you spoke of might be the winners. Coming to the end of the seminar, the webinar, let me say that we try that We know that the knowledge of staircase is extremely congested, but through such webinars with thought leaders like you, we try to add one small step to that extremely congested knowledge of staircase of knowledge. I hope we have done it. We've got some very good responses from discerning people who have been on the webinar. Plus, there is a request, Siddharth, to present a summary of the webinar to the people. And there is also one more request from my side. Any questions which I have not been able to address because they did not fall into the buckets which could be accommodated in this time space should be please addressed to the panelist and concerned panelist and then replied to. So thank you very much. Really appreciate your being with us and thank you the audience also. It was a superb audience. Questions are still coming. Thank you very much. I hope the answers will also return to you. Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.